The rain is coming down. There are puddles everywhere. This is like incredible. We're just going out looking at this. What is this? Rain in California. Oh my gosh. Now, last night, very important event took place. I was lying in bed just before going to sleep, and I was aware of this translucent pillar-like shape, like in the sort of a shape of a cloud-like pillar, like a vertical cloud-like shape, translucent, slowly moving and slowly changing. And out of this was emerging these ineffable emanations. And they would spread out. It was like incredibly beautiful. I just sit there watching this. I said, oh, what? My gosh, look at this. It's just incredibly beautiful. Like clear light. The light was like clear. Then I went to bed, and then boom, woken up at 3:30 in the morning. And frantically trying to make a proper alignment with truth in the morning, because the times are so urgent right now. And what emerged was this amazing, amazing paradigm, and I'm going to share it right here in this video. If it's possible to explain it, I believe it is. I've said that our problem is a continuity problem. That means we don't remember reality. In fact, we are so forgetful of it, we don't have a clue what it's like. We take this world to represent reality to us, when in fact it's an effort to forget reality. Something utterly different, actually. Now, in order to remember reality, we need to remember, be reminded of the nature of reality. And the nature of reality is that the emanations of God, the Prime Creator, are freely given to all creation. And they're all emanations are eternal. None can be harmed or changed in any way. And all of creation receives everything. How do we remember this when we're in a world of things? Okay. Well, enter the Holy Spirit. What I was told this morning and shown is that what the Holy Spirit does is to, let's say we sit down beside the Holy Spirit. In other words, our attention is there with the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit begins to emanate these beautiful gifts, these beautiful emanations, sublime emanations, ineffable. And these emanations are freely given. To everything in the universe. And all we do is we simply observe and be aware of the gifts the Holy Spirit is giving to everything in the universe, these beautiful emanations. And in doing this, we remember, this is how reality is. This is how God giving these emanations to everything in creation. It's like the Holy Spirit has this massive, inexhaustible supply of riches, and it's passing them out to everything. And you're just sitting there seeing what is passing out. It's just beauty after beauty after beauty after beauty after beauty. You just watch this free distribution of these emanations, which are intangible. They're not tangible. Okay, so we can't possess them, we can't grab them, we cannot put them in a museum, we can't hoard them, we cannot own them at all. Not at all. They're ineffable, they're intangible. And yet the mind's eye is able to see them and experience them. I was just like, watching, I just said, oh my gosh, I've never seen anything so beautiful. It's incredible. Just amazing. But you can't own it. And you can't copy it. And our only responsibility in this regard is to just bear witness to this so we can remember how reality functions in this way. So this is certainly one aspect of the resolving of our continuity problem. Certainly one aspect of it. It may be that this is something that when we're sleeping, our eyes are closed, that we're able to be aware of this. I don't know exactly how this works. But the important thing is to keep in mind that here in this world, the ego tells us it has a plan, which is to distribute things to everybody. And it says your job is to make sure that these beautiful material things, that you make sure everybody has one. Here's one. And it tells us that it can do what the Holy Spirit can do. Let us keep in mind something very important about the ego. The ego doesn't know what we are. The ego doesn't know what reality is. The ego doesn't know what satisfies us. The ego doesn't know how reality functions. It doesn't know how we function in reality. It doesn't know anything about us, actually. It was born in complete ignorance. It's a projection of a denial of reality. In other words, an ignorance of reality. An ignorance, an ignoring of reality. It doesn't know what its maker is because it's not a creation, it's a projection. So the ego claims that it knows how to save us and make us happy and how we need to be in order to be happy, etc. And yet it knows nothing about us, nothing about our home, nothing about our Creator at all. And yet it insists that it can do that. It insists because that's the role we gave it. So it is just simply insisting, says, this is my role. That's the role that we gave it as a projection. So of course the ego is going to be very insistent that it can do this because we told it can do this. We said, ego, your job is to make us happy outside of reality. create a new reality which we like even better than reality. So the ego says, this is my role, and I can do this. This is what you like. This is what you like. Why? Because we told the ego, this is what we want. But it doesn't know at all how to save us. Not in the slightest bit. So following the ego's advice is extraordinarily bad. The ego always does tune us. It says, sure. You want the Holy Spirit to pass out presence? Great, I'll share the stage and I'll pass out things. And together, both doing this, you'll be even happier than if we just had the gifts of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to pass out tangible things. You can own them. You can possess them. You can, you know, have a museum. You can have a showcase. You can sell them. You can trade them. You can do all this stuff. That's even better. I mean, let's have both of that. That's what makes you happy. So we have this world of things, of money, of possessions, all this stuff. But how can a thing possession be shared with the entire universe equally, forever, right now? It cannot. Only the intangible, the spiritual essences are truly shareable among spirit, right? Trying to share things equally among forms, bodies, is a completely maniacal, insane idea. If we look at it, it's just utterly whimsical and crazy. Because a thing has a location, whereas an essence is a mind, is essential creation, thought creation, idea creation, that is equally in all minds, in the one mind. We have the one identity. It is equally, it's non-localized in that way. Totally non-localized as a thing, as a crystallization. It can be shared equally with all minds. There's just one mind really, but all aspects. Whereas if we have a thing, the thing is here, it's I have this thing. It's got a thing identity, a thing location, a location relative to other things. All right. And this does not remind us of reality. The bartering in things, the whole life of thingness that we're engaged in here, does not remind us of how reality works at all. In fact, it causes forgetfulness, severe forgetfulness. But the ego insists it share the stage with the Holy Spirit, and what we have to insist on is no. Just one, just the Holy Spirit passing out these gifts, emanating these beautiful emanations, these sublime emanations, without any ownership claim, anything. They're just there for us to experience, so we remember, oh, this is like creation, reality. And that's all we're supposed to do. We're supposed to just be aware of this, and just be aware of it. That's it. We're not supposed to try and figure out a way to put this into a material form at all. In other words, we're not supposed to be painting, say, oh, I got an inspiration, I saw something so beautiful, you know, sublime, let me see if I can paint this on a canvas. Why? Well, because then you can own it, and then you can sell it, or somebody else can sell it. I have this possession, I have this. No. You're not supposed to make a musical composition out of it. You're not supposed to reify it, which means to concretize it. That is a big no-no. And if you look at the history of the high spiritual practice, you see the yogis in meditation, they're not painting and creating music and architecture and saying, look, this is what it looks like. No, because when you reify it, it's a thing and you lose the whole purpose of it. The whole purpose is to experience these ephemeral, beautiful, ephemeral, sublime spirit essence ideas that are emanating from this cloud. It's like the Holy Spirit's like this cloud. We talk about cloud computing, where we have all this data in a cloud, as it were, right? Well, the Holy Spirit is like this cloud that has all this riches in it. It just emanates out of this cloud. Just something comes out of the cloud, you see, boom, like that. It's like, ah, something just has emerged from the cloud. It's this amazingly beautiful essence that we see with our mind's eye. And so our job is to simply watch this, watch the emanations, just enjoy the emanations. And to those who say, what does it look like? Well, sit down and enjoy yourself. It's right there for you. We're not supposed to spend our time trying to reify these emanations. That's the big mistake that I have fallen for over and over again. And you think, if I could just do some special effect, I can kind of model this, you know, this model. Of course, the ego's frantically trying to produce all these special effects that can wow people, you know. But it's not the same. The ego cannot do what the Holy Spirit can do. And it doesn't know what we really need to pay attention to. It doesn't. So the discipline is don't reify them. Don't turn them in. Don't concretize these emanations. Don't say, well, there's this blue, I'm going to paint it, you know. I'm going to spend about 3 weeks here. I'm going to try to make this awesome painting of this emanation that I saw. No, because it's the entire situation is important. The cloud of the Holy Spirit, the emanations, how they emanate from the Holy Spirit, how they are there in pure spaciousness, and how they're untouched, you know, completely untouched, and so translucent and clear light in this pure spaciousness. It's the whole, and how they keep coming, they keep emanating. The whole point is just to be reminded of creation. If you put it into like a painting, concrete, you know, the frame on it instead of on a wall, you're misleading people. People are being misled. and thinking that, you know, yeah, I mean, I know people who have, you know, houses full of paintings, and they think that they're well, spiritually very wealthy. You know, this is reminding them reality. No, it's not. It's reminding you of the ego. So the discipline is to remain just observant. Just observant. That's it. That's the discipline. And I was able to do that last night. I didn't feel like, oh my God, I gotta rush to the keyboard and compose something, an ode, you know, some concerto or some song in praise of this emanations I'm seeing. No. That defeats the purpose. That's the ego that's saying that. Just keep watching. Just keep observing. Just keep the flow. Just see the keep observing the flow. Just be there with the Holy Spirit and as it dispenses its infinite riches. Now, so this is an incredible new awareness, as it were, of a dynamic here. And again, all we need to say to people is what does it look like? Well, fine. See for yourself. See for yourself. That's what it's for. It's all about seeing for yourself. And I say, it's so selfish, you're not sharing. Well, actually, you can just easily see for yourself. So what's the big deal? Just sit down and observe. The Holy Spirit will do the same thing for you. There's nothing special. You see, what we're doing is also experiencing the total non-specialness of the whole universe. Let these emanations just, let them be free. Let them be free. Don't try to cage them. Don't try to put them in a cage, a concrete cage of any material format. Let them remain free. And grant perfect non-special status to everything. So there's sort of a constellation here coming together of this granting this perfect non-specialness to everything. No demand that any specialness exist anywhere. And then allowing this perfect freedom of these idea essences of the Holy Spirit to be free of being possessed, you know, in other words, if someone has them, that's they're special. There's some, or it went specially to somebody. These things are just going out into this pure spaciousness. Just let them go, like birds flying in the sky. Just let them go like that. Just let them arise and float. Don't try to possess them. This is the challenge. So we don't want to deprive people of the challenge. You know, the challenge is there. The discipline is there for those who say, okay, let's take up the challenge. Now, let's switch gears a little bit to what's going on in the world. Because this technique, this meditation, this sadhana, is something that is very timely, revealed in a very timely fashion. It's an effortless sadhana, isn't it? You just watch the Holy Spirit emanate these riches and just enjoy it. That's all. What I got today and during the daytime was an unbelievable amount of portents, again, of the times that we live in. And how the red hand is about to strike. It's about to strike. And that's the ego and its minions and loyalists who trust in its advice about salvation are going to attempt to impose their values on a global scale. An attempt to wipe out any opposing value system. They're going to bring the heavy hand of derision and inquisition and attacking the flesh and all of that to bring about this globalization of their value system and the whole value system that aims at freeing everyone from the specialness. The ego is just opposite. It wants everyone to feel special. It wants them to have a special possession, special things, special location, things that belong to them. It wants to create this kingdom of specialness, the materiality of things. So I've always been told that there will come a time in the first part of the 21st century where there's going to be this severe crackdown. The turnover times. And the indications are that it is at hand. It is at hand. Which is why I've been pushing with all out effort to try and make the necessary breakthroughs and clarifications here before it's too late. The mood of the world is ready for it. The mood, those who are aligned with the ego, they're chomping at the bit and they're ready to make their move. And they feel that they can win. They can win this struggle. Now, once you know what true sadhana, our spiritual practice, is, you sidestep the whole thing, because right spiritual practice is to simply have this attitude of, I release the entire universe from my demand to be any specialist whatsoever, and then to watch the emanations of the Holy Spirit. Just watch them and enjoy this incredible movie. It's like a movie. Imagine if you were to sit down and watch this movie, and the movie was full of this most beautiful special effects that just said, oh my God, that is so beautiful. And it went on, and it was more and more beautiful, and there seemed the variety. There's just no end to the incredible beauty. And that's all you had to do. That's all you had to do. You just get the popcorn and enjoy. As a matter of fact, a couple days ago, I went to Trader Joe's and bought some popcorn. I said, you know what? It's time for some popcorn. Ate the whole bag. Maybe I'll get some more. It's time for the popcorn. You just sit back and watch. That's all we have to do. Salvation is something that's been done for us. It's not something we do. It's something that's been done for us. We just, our role is simply to enjoy it. Enjoy it. So we don't have to be involved in some civil war, some global conflict, some battle or anything like that. That has nothing to do with right spiritual practice. Nothing to do with it. Nothing to do with it. Nothing to do with it. Battle has nothing to do with right spiritual practice. In spite of the Bhagavad Gita saying that Krishna said, well, I must fight my enemies and just, No, it has nothing to do with it. That was symbolic anyway, but Jesus was not a general. They were expecting a general. Their Messiah was like David. King David. They wanted a great general who would destroy all their enemies, create a unified kingdom, and with them, of course, on the top, as the top rulers in bureaucracy, making everything right. And Jesus was not the general. They were so upset that he's saying no. just pray and be humble. And he said what you're supposed to do, trust in the Holy Spirit. And by the way, of course, Jesus said you can reject Jesus, you can reject God, but don't reject the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit has these gifts for you. See, the Holy Spirit will share with the entire universe all these gifts, and all you have to do is watch it. Watch this. So we don't have to enter into battle on any side. There is no side to this universal sharing, this shared identity, this complete freedom from specialness. See, this plant, I free this plant from plant specialness. I free this table from table specialness. I free this concrete walkway from concrete walkway specialness. I free this tree from tree specialness. I free that wall from wall specialness. I free this body from body specialness. I free this light from light specialness. I free this sky from sky specialness. You see, this is a very powerful spiritual practice. I free this plant of all plant specialness. I free this plant of my demand for any plant specialness. I free this plant from all plant specialness. Is the plant still there? Well, what is there is the one, is the oneness, is the pure spaciousness. So we can free the entire universe at one decision, but we can practice using specific situations. And I think the result of this practicing is the Holy Spirit, you being aware of its beautiful emanations, so you can be reminded of the creation, that functional creation of God, plus the feeling of this pure spaciousness, the feeling of oneness. Also, I think there's both of those are present. Because creation is not static. Creation, God is pouring out emanations continuously, as are we. We're co-creating with God, pouring out emanations, non-special emanations, not non-crystallized. I free everything from its specialness, any specialness. I free this rain from rain specialness. I free this bottle from all bottle specialness. Very simple to just simply to say this, and it's pretty easy to get. And just as far as, I kind of understand. I feel this post. You see this post? It's this post. It's like a thing. This is a post. I know. I free this post from all post specialness. Then what is it? Is it a post? Or is it the one? Is it the one as a post? Is it a post or the one with an emanation as a post? A post? What is it? It's not just a post, is it? There's no post specialness. I free the post from post specialness. We can't get this intellectually, but we can get it experientially. We can actually experience it. I free this day from all day specialness. I free this planet from all planet specialness. I free this planet from planet specialness. I free this universe from universe specialness. I free this moment from moment specialness. I free this garden from garden specialness. I free this insect from insect specialness. I free that flower from flower specialness. I free that leaf from leaf specialness. I free this puddle from puddle specialness. I free this land from land specialness. I free this water from water specialness. I free this rock from rock specialness. I free this song from song specialness. I free this bird from bird specialness. I free that star from star specialness. I free this pain from pain specialness. I free this death from death specialness. I free this life from life specialness. I free that screen from screen specialness. I free that image from image specialness. I free this wind from wind specialness. I free that basket from basket specialness. So on and on and on and on and on. I free this shrub from shrub specialness. I free those pavers from paver specialness. Now you're freeing the entire universe. Simply, you decided you're going to set the universe free. You're going to set spaciousness free. It's already free, but we don't realize that. So we have to. Ourselves, since we have believed it's not free, we have to then take this step and say, yes, it is free. Yes, it is free. and take the step like I'm setting it free. We need to take that step. Because we have to admit that we tried to bind it in the first place. So I said, I tried to bind it, now I'm letting it go in my mind. In our mind, it seems bound, but in reality, it's not bound. Pure spaciousness is not bound. It's not bound by anything. So I free that pot from pot specialness. I free that orange from orange specialness. I free this shoe from shoe specialness. I free that car from car specialness. I free this age from age specialness. Whatever there is, I free this crisis from crisis specialness. I free this conflict from conflict specialness. So here's a new technique that is very powerful. We have the others, many techniques I've given out, and they're all very powerful. This one is just, you know, just tremendously powerful. I free that roof from roof specialness. I free that house from house specialness. I free that street from street specialness. I free that telephone pole from telephone pole specialness. I free that hill from hill specialness. I free that mountain from mountain specialness. I free that forest from forest specialness. Now it's important that we do these exercises. I came across someone yesterday that seemed to be awakened. Now, I don't know, because who am I to know for sure? But the awakening was so intense, it was like a little scary, actually. So it's very important to stay in the mood of repentance, okay, for all of us. If you're awake, fine, then you're awake. But for those who are not awake, stay in the mood of repentance, stay humble, stay calm, stay sober, stay serious, stay non-reactive. Don't try to concretize anything, give that up. And do these practices soberly. The wild person who's free, you know, just like in this state of just utter freedom and abandon, dancing in the love of everything, you know, that can be extremely intimidating. I tend to gravitate more towards those like Ramana Maharshi and Ananda Maima, who are incredibly serene. Vast stillness, incredible vast stillness. Instead of the dancing, pulsing, vibrancy of you know, all this stuff, whatever. Now, not judging that, I'm just saying at this point I tend to feel a little more comfortable with that. And I think most people do. Monk Jempa said, beyond all pulsations, all thought pulsations, as they were, all the pulsations, beyond that is this sublime stillness. Ramana Maharshi said that the true realization is this great stillness, this great peace, this great quiet, beyond the pulsations, you know. So, well, we'll see. But I feel that this... Try to remain in a serene condition. Now, of course, we're not serene. We're bubbling over with concern. But hold yourself as if you were serene. You're, hold this attitude as if you were serene. You're calm. You're sober. You're not running off to the piano to make a composition. You know, like, oh my gosh, I saw that. I feel so inspired. If you see the oneness, if the demand for specialness is lifted off of everything, we'll see how you feel, but as you practice, maintain the serenity. Again, not judging the wild man, the wild woman thing of just this, you know, dancing, this guy, this dancing, you know, it's like dancing in freedom and just this to be totally ecstatic, you know, exuberant ecstatic stuff. Maybe at some point we will want that, I don't know. But I find it to be a little bit unnerving. And where we're at is where we need to practice. Okay, we have a severe continuity problem. If we don't have it, if the continuity problem is totally resolved for us, then we will take that, cross that bridge when we get there. But it's not, we have not resolved it for ourselves. We have not accepted the resolution. We do not have the vision of oneness. We do not have abiding in the beautiful emanation movie of the Holy Spirit. And so, we need to continue on with this attitude of serenity, serious serenity. You know, we're focused on. I free that plant from all plant specialness. I see this plant as free of plant specialness. Right, this plant as it is free of plant specialness. This flower, as it is free of flower specialness. This scenery, as it is free of scenery specialness. Set everything free of it, the specialness that we see as our perception. Our perception stamps upon everything this specialness, a localized specialness, which causes judgment, brings about judgment. So free everything from thing specialness. That stonework as it is free of stonework specialness. This table as it is free of table specialness. This table is free of table specialness. This air is free of air specialness. This space is free of space specialness. This talk is free of talk specialness. This ladder is free of ladder specialness. This ladder as it is free of ladder specialness. This darkness as it is free of darkness specialness. This coldness as it is free of coldness specialness. This perception as it is free of perception specialness. Now, you know, this is a practice just occurred to me just as I'm taping here. And this is an incredible practice. Anybody can do it. It's free, right? Anyone can do it anywhere. Just say, that flower, as it is free of all flower specialness. Set it free. Set that flower free. Set that flower free and see what happens. Set everything free and see what happens. Or what doesn't happen. We won't get into word games or that. Not at this point. Not at this point. We're focusing on this practice. Instead of trying to imprison the flower, saying, ah, flower, you're so beautiful, flower, I love you, flower, this is what I want, flower, set the flower free, see, flower, that flower, flower, as it is, that flower, as you are, flower, as that flower as it is, is totally free of all flower specialness. Is totally free of all flower specialness. This world as it is totally free of all. This world as it is totally free of all world specialness. This universe as it is totally free of all universe specialness. This is something extraordinary. This is an extraordinary technique. Let me bump this up a little bit. And it's like kind of like, wow, how come we never heard this before? How come we've been, you know, wow, what took us so long? What took so long to try this technique? It's incredible. It's incredible. It's like rehearsing our release of the whole universe from specialness. Everything, a release of everything from all our demand for its specialness. From our demand for specialness. That's what we're rehearsing. This food, as it is free of all food specialness. This breath, as it is free of all breath specialness. Everything is free of all specialness, of all everything specialness. Just everything is free of all specialness, I'd say. So this is a brand spanking new spiritual practice, which is just incredibly intense but easy. Easy intensity, let's call it. This is the way of easy intensity. So we're not bound anymore by our discursive thoughts and considerations. We can actually use these very condensed, powerful declarations of freedom. And don't say to God, God, set me free, I'm so trapped, please set me free. No, declare that you're setting the universe free, because the universe is just a projection. But what we are seeing, all the thingness, is our projection. So we have to declare that we're giving up projection. And this is how we do it. We need to practice giving up projection. We have to practice it because it is such a vast, intense projection. We tried to literally get rid of reality and make a substitute, you know, and prove that God can be destroyed. And it's very vast and intense. So let's practice it first. You know, let's not just try to, boom, just do it. If there's something that can't find, but for us, let's practice it first. Let's make our declarations. They're a little feeble, right? I mean, if you start out, we're very feeble, like scared. Oh my God, I might lose all my projections. No, gently, step by step by step. And remember, when we're willing to drop our projection, all projection, the Holy Spirit has this movie for us. It's seeing the projections, the emanations that the Holy Spirit's giving for us. We can watch that. We can watch that. Get our popcorn. So let's practice. Our practice is very feeble. There's no question in my observation of the world that our practice, our spiritual practice here, is incredibly feeble. We're very, very nervous about it. Just the fact that nobody's saying, hey, this plant as it is free, totally free of plant specialness. This light as it is totally free of light specialness. This atmosphere as it is totally free of atmosphere specialness. But you just don't hear that. We're so timid. We're incredibly timid. So we do need to practice and find our voice a little bit at a time here. Just, you can do gentle practice if you're so scared, very timid. Realize, hey, I'm very timid. And so I just say that this table, This table is free of all table specialists. This table is free of all tables. Just try it one time to say something. Your computer. This computer is free of all computer specialists. This computer as it is free of all computer specialists. This computer as it is free of all computer specialists. See, be gentle with yourself. You're not trying to turn yourself into an ecstatic wild dancer, okay? We're gently washing away our commitment to projection and specialness. And if you don't want to do it, that's fine too. You may say, I'm scared, well, that's fine, but you don't have to do it. But if you want to do it, it's simple. Like this computer, as it is totally free of all computer specialists. You can use the all or not. You can just say this computer is free of computer specialists. That's the simplest form. This computer is free of computer specialists. Then you can say this computer as it is free of computer specialists. And you can say this computer as it is totally free of computer specialists. You can say that. And then you can say this computer as it is totally free of all computer specialists. See, that's the strongest form. This computer as it is totally free of all computer specialists. But you can start out to say this computer is free of computer specialists. That's enough to start. That's how I started. Now you can, as you get more confident, you can add the more emphasis. This computer, as it is totally free of all computer specialists. Everything, as it is totally free of all specialists. And then you can, step it up to other things, bigger things, smaller things, the whole spectrum. Include the whole spectrum in your practice. Include the whole spectrum. This atom. As it is totally free of all atom specialness. This photon, as it is totally free of all photon specialness. This quark, as it is totally free of all quark specialness. This string particle, as it is totally free of all string particle specialness. This cosmos, as it is totally free of all cosmos specialness. This Milky Way galaxy, as it is totally free of all Milky Way galaxy specialness. This Pacific Ocean, as it is totally free of all Pacific Ocean specialness. Right now, I release everything from any demand for specialness. Everything is free of any demand for specialness right now. But it's important just to do these exercises, get comfortable with them. We don't have to try and make this big breakthrough, We don't have to jump right into radical surgery. Come on, we can gently erase our resistance gently, bit by bit. Don't say, I am free. Say, the whole universe is free. The whole universe is free. Because our perception is out there, put your declarations out there. Okay, don't outsmart yourself. So, we're freeing everything. Now, if we free everything from all specialness, if we free everywhereness, I free all everywhereness from all specialness, then mustn't we also be dwelling in perfect freedom from specialness too? Because we must be in everywhereness, right? So when you set everything free, you too must be free because you're dwelling in perfect freedom. How could you not be free? Everything you behold is free. So where is your lack of freedom? This is a point that's difficult to get. I still don't get it entirely. But you can see that there's this reason there, right? But still, just seeing everything as perfectly free is this most incredible feeling. It's kind of like this gratitude. You feel this like unending gratitude, I would say. Something like that. Extreme unending gratitude. Vast, boundless gratitude. And appreciation. This vast gratitude and appreciation. Everything is free. I thought I had bound it forever. You see, we think we have bound ourselves. When I say self, we're one self, the one identity, which is of all. So we think we've bound the all, everything. We've bound it forever in death, in specialness. That's what we believe. That is what we believe. We believe that to an extreme extent. And then when we see, oh my gosh, I released everything. It's all, everything's free. It's not bound at all. It's just this incredible relief. Incredible relief. Gratitude. It's just radiant relief and gratitude and appreciation and just amazement and just such, so relieved. What we thought was damnation forever, we see it has now been lifted. It has been lifted. It is gone. I just want to capture this rain here, California. This is actually rain. It's really the first legitimate rain in like 14 months really here. Really legitimate. This is actually legitimate rain. It's an actual soaking. Everything else was just, you know, pretense. I looked at a before and after pictures of the reservoirs in California. And it's just unbelievable. I mean, it's scary. It's really scary. These huge reservoirs we get our water from are, you know, going close to empty. And the federal water management said the farmers aren't getting any water from the central water system. It's going to people. The farmers aren't getting any. So that they have to resort to wells. You know? Whew. So hopefully it'll keep on raining here. Pray for rain in California. Of course, if we do that, we may get more than we expect, more than we need. But if everybody that can pray for rain in California, that would be great. So we're just kind of hanging out here, having introduced two incredible new births, as it were, in this world of clarification, of at least right here, right now, of this the Holy Spirit's emanation from this cloud-like presence, and just simply enjoying these emanations without trying to concretize them. Reminding us of reality, and then this technique of this plant as it is totally free of all plant specialness, of specifically working on lifting our demand upon the entire universe and the universe of universes, that there be specialness anywhere. If there's specialness anywhere, there's specialness everywhere. Okay, this is very important. Very important to understand this. If there's specialness anywhere, there's specialness everywhere. When we want anything at all to be special, we will see everything as special. Everything is trapped in crystallization. People lose the sense of God, pure spaciousness, the zero dimensionality of God. People lose that. We won't see it. We won't be aware of it. That's why Jesus is so adamant in A Course in Miracles of saying, do not make a single exception. Do not make a single exception. That is all important. Because we think, well, I can see everything is not special, but one thing is special. It's no problem. Now, that's the ego that's saying that. The ego says you can see reality as having specialness and also as not having specialness. That's duality. That's the insanity of the ego. That is duality. That's totally not understanding reality. The ego does not know reality at all. It doesn't have a clue. So it just tells us, oh, yeah, there's no problem. No problem with this. It doesn't know reality. So it's easy for the ego to say no problem. But it's completely ignorant. It's completely ignorant. Reality is one seamless whole. You cannot have a part of reality a certain way without all of reality being that way. It's impossible. So you cannot demand that a part of reality be special without the demand that all of reality be special, trapped in specialness, which is death, which is crystallization, which is damnation. It's impossible. So you cannot make a single exception. You must lift your demand off of all of it. But because we're so used to trying judgment, we have to start from where we're at. That's why these practices are necessary. You have to start from where you're at. You can't pull yourself up by the bootstraps. So we are so habituated to judgment, thinking higher and lesser degrees of specialness, and thinking that something can be special and something else cannot be, etc., etc. We have to practice specific practice. This plant, as it is totally free of all plant specialness. Okay. Now, what you're doing is you're expressing an attitude of total freedom from specialness, directing it towards that plant. But really, when your attitude is, I am releasing this from all specialness, you're really extending that to everything. Because we don't realize it yet. We don't realize it. Because we still think it's possible to do both. You cannot do both. That's the ego. That's duality. That's delusion. We're practicing the attitude, the act of freeing from our demand that anything be special. But we practice step by step. This. That's how it's done. That's pragmatism in action. Don't outsmart yourself. The ego will tell you, nah, you don't need to do that. You'll outsmart yourself. Because remember, we have a severe continuity problem. And if I can do this, anyone can, because I'm the type who wants to just say, I can just go, let's just do the whole thing right now, we can do it. It's that attitude. And so if I can do this, anybody can. It takes humility, right? It takes humility. It's saying, hey, you know what? I have to do it this way, because trying to do it all at once is I'm too habituated to falsity and judgment. It takes humility. Saying, I can do it all at once means, I'm not any problem with judgment and specialness and all this kind of stuff. No, just brush it aside. I don't have any problem with it. who can say that, really? Yeah, who can really say that? Maybe those who practice for a long, long time. But that's because they practice a long, long time. They should make that clear. We all have a severe continuity problem. Severe. So we do need to practice specifically like this. Cannot dispense with it. I tried to do it without it. Failed. Failed. Failure. For sure. Failed. I tried and tried and tried and tried and tried. So I can get it. I get the overall concept. That's enough. That's good. Failed. Didn't work. Didn't work. Continuity problem is still there. So remember, even the most audacious ones, the most courageous and audacious, even they have to practice specifically like this. Even they can't do it directly, no way. They'll fail too. Everyone will fail that way. Almost everyone, almost. And who wants to be the one that does it? Who cares, right? Who cares? Doesn't matter. There's no special prize for if there happens to be someone who can really just, boom, super rare. Jesus said it's incredibly rare. And it doesn't really matter, doesn't matter, because there's no different. They'll see the exact same gratitude and appreciation for doing it that fast. So be smart. Be smart. Do it the safe way. Be smart. Be humble. Be humble, which is being smart, which is being pragmatic. Being smart means being pragmatic. In other words, doing what works. So, this plant as it is totally free of all plant specialists. This table as it is totally free of all table specialists. This computer as it is totally free of all computer specialists. As it is, meaning right this instant, without an instant of time taking place. Without even an instant of time taking place. Okay, that's what it, as it is, that's what it means. Without even an instant of time taking place. It's free right now, before even an instant of time passes. So this plant, as it is totally free of all plant specialness. This time, as it is totally free of all time specialness. This conceptualization, as it is totally free of all conceptualization specialness. Now, the driver arrived today. Very interesting. I said I went to a very low loft, 8.5. And most people, the big buzz now is go higher loft, 11.5, 12.5. You know, get more is better. Add loft. But really, that's grandiosity. It's very interesting because what I'm saying is, let's take the humble path, the safe, pragmatic path of specific spiritual practicing like this. And the world is taking the path saying, we don't need this, we don't need this. That's the ego's telling them that. The ego says, you don't need that. Because we're combining truth and lies, and you don't have to practice at all. We got the big picture, the ego says. We got the high picture. You know, we're going to ascend that way. And those people who are doing this plant as it is totally free of all plant specialness. Oh, it's just such wimpy stuff, you know. It's aiming low. How can you succeed when you aim so low? That's the ego spiel at this time in the world. So everybody's all pumped up, says, we're aiming higher. The ego always says this, aiming higher, okay? Whenever you try to do a spiritual exercise, their ego goes, gotta aim higher than that. Aim higher than that. So, the Holy Spirit told me, get this golf club that's got the lowest loft, 8.5, very low loft, extremely low loft. Get that. Aim lower. All right, you'll get more distance, actually. You'll go further when you aim lower. I said, wow, I'll try it out. I trust you. It was a big step for me. I said, wow. You know, most people say, you're crazy. No way you can hit that thing. I said, well, we'll find out. I think I can. I don't know. It's raining right now, so I can't try it. But so we're aiming lower here to go further. We're using these wimpy little, things, this table, this computer, this wall as it is totally free of all specialness. And of course the ego just laugh at that and say, it's ridiculous, it's totally archaic, are you kidding? We got all this stuff now we can hook you up to, your brain waves, we can hook your brain waves up, we can pipe this special tonal stuff into your brain. I mean, we got this therapy stuff coming down, and it's just unbelievable. You can't believe we'll have lights, all these frequency lights flashing, and it'll put you into all these alpha states, and we'll give you this reprogramming stuff, subliminal reprogramming, and we'll put this nanotechnology in you. I mean, this stuff's incredible. You know, you're going to be able to both experience both truth and lies as one, and you'll be so far advanced. I mean, you're going to ascend into this incredible golden age, and here you are saying this wall as it is totally free of all wall specialists. I mean, that is so ridiculous, it's so incredibly. So the ego says you're a complete idiot, you're a tortoise, you're going so slow, it's pathetic, They feel sorry for you, and actually they want to put you out of your misery. Actually, the ego, its goal, the goal of the red hand in the world, okay? Its goal is to put all us poor, pathetic, retrograde morons out of our misery. They think they're doing us a favor. Does it sound familiar? Eugenics, Nazi Germany, sound familiar? Yeah, it's exactly what it was. They said, you know what? These people are dead, evolutionary dead end. And we're doing them a favor. We're doing them a favor. Putting them out of their misery so they don't keep reproducing, you know, keep reproducing this misery. The way to stop the misery, stop the reproduction. How? You know, put them in pits and bulldoze them. Gas them and bulldoze them. So that's what the red hand is all about, actually, in the world. It thinks it's saving the world because the world's ready to move on. You know, this is the move on people, right? It's ready to move on, folks. It's the move on folks, the red hand folks, who said, you know what? This, those who are saying this wall, as it is totally free of all specialness. And those who sit there and merely watch the ethereal and sublime emanations of this, the cloud of this Holy Spirit presence, and just sitting there in this beatitude, oh my God, they're so retrograde. It's evolutionary dead end. They're intractably caught up in some kind of psyche madness of the psyche. And we don't want them reproducing. In fact, we don't want them ideologically contaminating anybody here. All the new, you know, the new fresh folks who are ready to move on. So we need to, you know, do the world a favor and get rid of them. That's the red hand. That is the red hand. That's exactly what they're about. Exactly what they're about. So of course we're afraid to practice. You see, when you think like, why am I so afraid? I can't even say this. That's why. That is why. Intimidation. You don't want to be an evolutionary dead end. Whereas, in fact, the truth is, it's the ego that's a dead end. They're a total dead end, and they will find that out. They'll run into the dead end themselves. But they're projecting it onto those who are actually don't have a dead end, who are opening up to the glorious life and remembrance of life. True life, eternal life. All life is eternal life. They project it onto them and say, oh no, they're the ones that have the dead end. We're going towards eternal life. They got it, you know, it's projection. Projection begins projection. Don't underestimate the insanity of projection. So in saying that, I expect that the whole pathway of sidestepping this madness will continue to open up. It's opening up for me step by step by step. And I expect it to continue because there's no way that we're going to accept that kind of stigmatization. And we're going to continue to aim lower to go further. Being humble, humble practice. This wall, I'm looking at a wall here behind the computer. This wall, as it is totally free of all wall specialists. Now, as we practice these specifics, what happens? What begins to happen? It begins to generalize. Okay? Don't try to generalize first. Do specifics first, and in through your practice with specifics, it will automatically generalize for you. Automatically. So don't put the cart in front of the horse. It will automatically generalize. And then when it generalizes, that's when you get the wow, I'm feeling the totality. There's just a sense of freedom from specialness. It's just all pervasive, with this all pervasiveness. In all pervasiveness of freedom. That's when the generalization, but the generalization happens organically and automatically. Don't try to force it. Keep working on specifics. Generalization will come. It will come. That's what Jesus tells us. I've already experienced that on several occasions already, where Oh, suddenly I felt the all-pervasiveness, that everyone was set free of specialness, vision of oneness. And it was the most great gratifying thing I've ever seen, you know. It was totally gratifying. Totally gratifying. I guess maybe that's the best way I can say it right now. Totally gratifying. There's no possession, no experience, special experience can ever touch the sense of total gratification of just seeing this. That, oh my gosh, everything is free. There's no damnation anywhere. But that came from just doing, you know, specific practice that I've been sharing on these videos. I don't have a driving problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a functioning problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a wall problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a computer problem. I have a continuity problem. You know, taking away all problems from everywhere and saying only the continuity problem. See, by doing that, it generalized for me. It generalized. So I've already had experiences of it generalizing. So I'm sure it'll happen again, but you can't force it. You can't force it. Cannot force it. So you just have to be patient. You have to continue your practice and don't look for results that way. Put your effort into the practice and results will come of themselves. You have to have faith in that. And of course the ego is ready to unleash a vast wave of derision upon the planet. Derision of anybody who believes in what we're talking about here. Massive derision. Massive beatdown of scorn and derision. And stigmatization. That's the first step, right? In Nazi Germany, we know what happened. We know in the world what happens. First, there's this massive derision, a state bureaucratic organized campaign of derision. And then, once you've dehumanized these people into a state of extreme scorn and derision, then you feel, well, you know what, the world's better off without them. The world's better off without them. And they're better off without themselves, too. You're doing them a favor. You get to that point. First, there's a massive derision. We've already had extreme derision taking place, but there's going to be a blitzkrieg of derision taking place in this world. Stigmatization and derision. There's been many instances of it already. Of individual derision, trying to generalize it. Well, the principle of generalization also works in reverse, where the ego, we get all these instances of derision. Many specific instances of derision, which already happened. At some point, that will all generalize in the psyche of the world. And the world will just have this generalized sense of derision towards all practitioners of right spiritual practice. All of those of faith, you know, faith in Jesus, faith in Christ, faith in God, faith in the Holy Spirit, faith in salvation, faith in right spiritual practice, whatever label they want to give it, you know. I'm totally ecumenical. As far as that goes, I don't see any specialness anywhere, right? I'm willing to lift all specialness off of everything, everything. But I don't insist that anybody, you know, has to be ecumenical. You can stay right within your tradition. You can stay right within your tradition. And I stay pretty much within the Judeo-Christian tradition, pretty much so. But I also will use something that someone might say, well, that kind of sounds non-dualistic, Buddhist or Advaita Vedanta-ish or something. But I'm very much set in the Judeo-Christian tradition, very familiar with that. And the curriculum I used was A Course in Miracles, which is a Judeo-Christian, part of the Judeo-Christian tradition. And I also used the Bible, too. Jesus used shorthand in the Bible. It's all there if you can decipher the shorthand with the help of the Holy Spirit, and some can. The ego's had a long time of trying to mess that all up. Okay, thousands of years of trying to confuse the issue. So, A Course in Miracles has had less time to try to confuse the issue. Not that it hasn't tried already, but it hasn't quite, you know, doesn't have the thousands of years of doing so. And keep a sense of humor about, you know, don't forget to laugh. Don't forget to chuckle. Don't forget to laugh about all this stuff. Absolutely. Because you say, oh, I'm going to be free of it anyway. So, you know, I'm feeling my freedom. I'm feeling my freedom. You know, it's like the ego. Really, the ego is so pathetic. You know, our projections are so pathetic. We should laugh at them. We should laugh at them. Yeah, there really is nothing to do but laugh. Ultimately, we'll just laugh it away, and that's it, because it's so ridiculously pathetic. Only good for a laugh. And so how soon is soon? How soon is soon? Well, it's always very soon, really, because even if it was a bit far off, that's still very, very soon. It's a very serious situation. But when the derision becomes crystallized, generalized, when it's very close to that, it is very close to that, to suddenly generalizing. I mean, I think it's happening really right now, actually. There's just a sense of, oh yeah, okay, this is it. And just there's no more resistance. The derision, you know, derision can be very delaying for us. And again, remember Jesus said in the Bible that in the end times, end of this world cycle, which is we're heavily into that, and he said the negativity, the darkness, the satanic influence on the planet at that time will be so strong, so intensely strong, that he said even the very elect of God, the saints, those who've elected to lift the specialness off of the universe and set the universe free of all damnation, even they will be in danger of succumbing to this derision, to this darkness. That's how dark, that is the intensity of the derision that is coming. So pragmatically, for me, I say, hey, you know, let's play, be safe and sidestep it. I don't want to be any hero. I don't want to try and prove I'm special, that I can somehow withstand that or something. Forget it. You know, I just want success. You know, I don't care. I don't want to be put to some kind of ultimate challenge. I want to do the safe, pragmatic way that works. I don't want any more delay, so I don't want to risk delay. That's stupid. Risking delay is stupid. I've already done that. I've already, you know, flirted with temptation and found out, you know, that the ego has its ways to really intimidate you. So it delayed me. So why be delayed anymore? That's stupid. We're not called to stupidity. We're called to pure pragmatism. So if we can sidestep the derision of the red hand in this world, by all means we should do it. By all means. And of course the ego says, oh, you're going into a dead end. You don't know how to practice. You don't know what real therapy is at all. You're ignorant. We have superior therapy. No, it doesn't. There isn't any therapy superior to saying, just right now, this plant, as it is totally free of all plant specialness. Right? There's not some superior modality to that. That is like supreme spiritual practice right there. So if you're practicing that, you are a supreme practitioner. You are part of the club of responsible society. You're part of responsible society. You're part of a club of right spiritual practice. Just from that simple practice, as you're looking at that wall, you just say that this wall as it is totally free of all wall specialness. That is uber, uber high, intense, totally intense, right-minded, right spiritual practice. Totally intense, right spiritual practice. The ego has nothing that can even remotely approach this. Nothing. The ego doesn't remotely approach that in any of its therapies, modalities, etc. It does not. Guaranteed. Promise you that. So this whole intimidation thing of the ego that says that you know, you're some kind of inferior, you know, you're inferior breed, and you need to be eugenically targeted. You know, really, we're dealing with spiritual eugenics on this planet right now. That's what we're talking about. It's spiritual eugenics that the ego is engaged in. So that its way is the only option. So ego and say, look, there is no other option, so this must work. That's its end game, right? Remove all option, remove the other option, the Holy Spirit. So we say there isn't anything else or something. But, in any time, in any place, wherever you are, happen to find yourself, you can always look at a wall, or you can look at a rock and say, this rock, as it is, meaning, as it is, this rock, as it is totally free of all rock specialness. You can always do that. You can always do that. So the ego's never got you. You're never bound by the ego, actually. But it tries to convince you that you are, or it tries to convince you that you're a complete idiot if you say such a thing. And that's very intimidating, right? Very intimidating. And like I said, even I can be intimidated. For sure. Whereas I'm speaking out like this, maybe more intensely than most people on the planet. Very few are able to speak this way. But I'm saying even I can be intimidated into, you know, failing and backing off, and then being, you know, submerged. Absolutely, that is possible. A concerted effort is absolutely possible to that. Any, you know, I could succumb to it for sure. So let's realize that if the opportunity to, if there's a way, a pathway to sidestep this spiritual eugenics, which is taking place right now. It's been taking place the last 50 years or so, actually. The last 30 it's been increased a great deal, and then the last 15 has been really bad. And it's accelerating at a quantum pace, and it's going to crystallize at some point. And I'm seeing signs that it's crystallizing. That's what I saw today. I said, it's going to crystallize now. Quickly. Crystallization, generalization, it's going to generalize. Generalization happens very quick, very, very quickly. Where if you express a viewpoint other than what the values the ego has, you are instantly, universally condemned without zero tolerance, without any option other than that. But remember, we're talking about right spiritual practice, so I don't care what anyone's attitude is towards anything. We simply say, look at that wall in front of you and say, this wall, exactly as it is totally free of all wall specialness. Just do that. That's all we are talking about. We are not talking about judgment. Right spiritual practice is not talking about judgment. We're not judging judgment, okay? We're not saying this person is right, their values are right. We're not saying this person, their values are right. We're not taking sides on judgment. We are saying simply, wherever you are, whatever is in front of you, look at that and say, this plant, as it is totally free of all plant specialness. Okay? And you, wherever you are, whoever you are, no matter what your judgment has been, you can set the entire world, universe free of all specialness. Again, this is a non-judgmental situation. Either way, we're not taking sides in cultural wars, in gender wars, in anything like that. Okay? We are saying right spiritual practice is what we stand for. Whatever you are, whatever's in front of you, whatever's around you. So this scene, this scenery, as it is totally free of all scenery specialness. Just practice. That's all we're saying. Just practice. That's all we're saying. The ego wants to set the whole world right first, according to its values. And then the ego says, then we'll get around to spiritual practice. We're saying, no. We start with where we are and right spiritual practice right now. So the ego got it backwards. The ego says, oh, we'll do all the right spiritual practice, but first we got to get rid of all these wrong values we have, all these people with the wrong judgments. Yeah. Well, you know, judgment is, judge not lest you be judged. There's all sorts of different judgments, depending on your point of view. There's all sorts of different points of view. Are they right or wrong? They're neither right nor wrong. They're just judgments. judgment itself is delusion. Okay? So Jesus said, don't judge at all. Judge not, lest ye be judged. He didn't say, judge, you're good. When they called him good, they said, why are you calling me good? I'm not good. That's a judgment. That's a judgment. Don't judge who's right or wrong. Right wherever you are, don't worry about who's right or wrong. Say, that wall, just as it is totally free of all wall specialness, and practice freeing the entire universe from your demand that it be special. Okay? That's what you do. Yeah, it's raining, you're really coming down now, as you can hear. That's great. Let it rain. So the ego totally doesn't get this at all. The ego does not get right spiritual practice at all. It always says, first, do something else first. Always. It will always say, do something else first. It never gets around to supporting right spiritual practice. It will never get around to it because it sees zero value in it. It sees it as total insanity because it has no idea about what reality is, about what spirit is, about what truth is. None. It only knows projection. That's it. So it will never get around to it. So if you're not getting around to it, you're listening to the ego. You're doing something else first. Put right spiritual practice first, and then let everything else take its place, fall in place. And we will find that right spiritual practice generalizes. This generalization will come, and we'll feel this presence, this absolute gratitude. This absolute gratitude that great damnation has been lifted off everything. There's no damnation anywhere. And then we'll realize that we're spirit. We're not form, we're spirit. We'll realize everything is spirit. We'll realize everything is spirit. All is spirit. All is pure spaciousness. We'll eventually know this. We'll eventually know it. So we don't need to practice more judgment. Alright? We don't need to practice judgment. We don't need to practice who's right and who's wrong on any issue. We don't need to exterminate those who disagree with us. We don't need to call them names. We don't have to judge our own judgments. Everybody has a consolation of judgment. We just say, whatever my opinions and judgments are on anything at all in the world, that's fine. I don't need to change any of that. I just need to do right spiritual practice. And that will free me from all judgment. All specialness. You can count on it. So that is the way the Holy Spirit tells us to go. That is the right advice because the Holy Spirit knows the Prime Creator, knows reality, knows truth, knows spirit, and knows how to remind us of truth and reality and Prime Creator and spirit. It knows perfectly. So it knows how to give us right advice. And the ego that only knows how to give us wrong advice. The ego always gives wrong advice, always. And it insists, of course, that its advice is the right advice. Because we told it. That's what they tell us this. Which is a projection. Now, I love doing these videos. I hope you love watching. Because there's all this noise going on, all this stuff going on. It's like, it feels very real. I should listen to my own videos sometime. I never do, really. But it'd probably be very enjoyable. There's all this stuff taking place here. But it's really practical, right? Because in the world, there's all this commotion taking place, right? All this commotion, always. And the ego tells us, hey, you know, you just make everything perfect in the world, then you can practice. The ego says, how can you practice with these cars driving on the street? You can't practice, right? You need like a perfect cave somewhere. And then you need the perfect food, and you need the perfect atmosphere, and you need the perfect setting, and you need those. Oh, yeah. Ego always makes excuses for you. Because you turn to the ego for excuses. That's what it's for. And the ego will give you all these excuses why you don't need to. It's not ready yet. You're not ready yet. But how difficult is it to look at that wall behind the computer and say, that wall, just as it is totally free of all wall specialness. How difficult is that? It doesn't matter what's going on, right? And if there's some cats crying, say, that cat, just as it is totally free of all cat specialness. And there's a car that drives by, say, that car, as it is totally free of all car specialness. And if it's raining, you see, that rain, as it is totally free of all rain specialness. Whatever arises, use that as practice. Grist for the mill. Grist for the mill of right spiritual practice. God, it's perfect. God, this arising, great. This is perfect. I'll just use that as practice. This coldness, as this chill, as it is totally free of all chill specialness. So as you can see, there's a lot of stuff working against us in this world, subtle stuff we don't realize, that we don't want to be stigmatized, and the ego is such a bully, because we told it to be such a bully. We told the ego to bully us, to intimidate us, to give us excuses, and so we always find, we keep coming across these excuses, but again, you can start out very gently, or not even start out at all if you don't want to. But just keep in mind, you can start very gently. This computer is free of all computer specialness. This video is free of all video specialness. Just look quietly to yourself so that you can start out quietly to yourself. And automatically, you're in the club. You're in the club of responsibility, the society of responsible society. You're a member of responsible society. You're a member of responsible society. And remember that society has those who look out after the members of right responsible society. There is that aspect to it, that look out after other members of responsible society. I'm not saying I'm one of those, but there are quote-unquote lifeguards of responsible society. Those who, and the Holy Spirit itself, looks out after responsible society. Those who are members of responsible society, we find that grace is making sure that their way is a lighted way. So it's important. Don't listen to the ego. The ego tells you if you start practicing like this, he's going to lower the boom on you. That's a lie. That's another lie. If you start practicing like that, grace is going to look out after you. Whereas if you say, no, I'm going to follow the ego's way, then what you're doing is you're telling the ego to look out after you. And we know how that goes. And the ego, of course, always brings punishment upon you. The ego says, I need to eradicate your tendency to go off into this crazy dead endness of spiritual practice. So I need to really give some very radical punishment to you to get rid of it. And you need to die to save yourself from yourself. And that's what happens, right? That's the ego. The ego says you need to die to save yourself from death. Save yourself from yourself. You need to die to save yourself from death. That's the ego's rationale, insanity. The ego thinks that if you're dead, you won't have this tendency to want to live, Just the cure for wanting to eternal life is eternal death. That's what the ego says. The ego wants to make you eternally dead, so to save you from eternal life, that's what it wants for you. So don't turn to the ego for help. Turn to the Holy Spirit for help and say, this computer, as it is totally, is totally free of all computer specialness. Just do it, and then the Holy Spirit, you realize it's on your side. You've chosen the side of eternal life and rejected the side of eternal death that the ego is trying to give you. And remember, there's no such thing as eternal death, so the ego will kill you over and over and over and over again, saying, this time you'll be eternally dead. I'm sure of it. And, oh, you're not. Oh, another body, you need to kill you again. That's the ego. That's all the ego's about. And so I know there's some of you actually practicing, I think. You never know who's going to actually practice. But just keep it general, keep it simple, keep it real easy. Real easy. This, whatever's around you, this flower. You see, you have a flower in a vase. This flower, as it is totally free of all flower specialness. You're setting that flower free of flower specialness. Okay? And you may think you're losing the beauty of the flower, but no. You're gaining the total gratitude of everything. Imagine if everything there is has this total gratitude towards you. That's what you'd be experiencing ultimately. You know, we're going towards that. Just, you feel this complete sense of gratitude from the entire universe. Like you set it free. You lifted damnation off of the entire universe. You did it from your simple decision. Just think of the gratitude towards you for that. And it's really the gratitude you have for yourself. But it seems to be coming to you because we're so used to the format of projection, okay? So it seems as if the whole universe is like completely grateful to you. Completely grateful to you. Just pure gratitude. The whole universe is pure gratitude towards you. That's another way to express the feeling, that the vision of oneness that I got. I got this sense like, I'm grateful to see all this, but there's also all this gratitude towards me. Like I did something, you know, just set them free. Lifted death off of everything. Imagine if you lifted death off of everything. How grateful everything would be to you for doing that. That's exactly, you know, how it feels. Just think how welcome you would be everywhere for doing this. You know, just think how welcome you are, you know? Just like, all right. So maybe give it a little gentle try. Just a little gentle try, you know? You can be very timid about it if you want. That's fine. Start out very timidly. That's okay. But I believe that a lot of you get the gist of what's said here. You can get the gist of it, for sure. I'm confident of that. I'm not as confident that people actually will try to start a little bit. But some will. It's possible that some will actually will. And later on, others will. They will. Later on, others will. Eventually, you will start, for sure. Eventually. No question about it. If not now, then a little later. It will happen. It will happen. Meanwhile, keep getting the gist of it. You know, just say, okay. You know, just let it settle in. That's all that's required. Okay. Thanks for watching. Very great. That's it for this one.